People in dark places need your light.
So God changed me. He gave me a new attitude, a new perspective. Because see, I believe the hope of the world starts with the gospel, getting into a person's heart.
The world is looking for a unified church. It means when you fall, I'm there to help pick you up.
And he says that I want you to be a direction in the darkness. I want you to be a compass in the chaos.
See, the gospel is the power of God, a salvation to those who believe.
But if you can shine your light in dark places, that's where it makes the most difference.
Welcome, Grace Family Church Online. I'm Taylor.
And I'm Brian, and we have a great service for you today. But before we get into the service, we would like to thank all our first timers for coming out today.
We are so excited to have you with us today, and we want to connect with you. So if you hit the website down here and click connect, you can reach out to us. I actually heard we have a great speaker in service today.
Yes, Pastor Hal is speaking with us today, and he is our pastor over at The Exchange.
If you are wondering what The Exchange is, it is the young adults group that was meeting on Tuesdays at 7:30 before the whole quarantine started. But it's really fun. We get together, there's worship, there's small groups, and it's just a great time for us to meet other people who are our age around the church.
Yes, and we have so much fun, and we would love to see you there.
Yeah, we have some really exciting news for you after service, but for now, let's worship together.
Done, done, he is risen, it is done, and I sing. And it is good to worship with you guys tonight. Whew, it has been just a crazy week, months. And I just want to be real with y'all. Man, do you ever feel like you're not enough? You know, like you're coming in here or you're watching online and you're just feeling like, that's great, but you're just feeling kind of stuck. You're not enough. Everything you're doing in your relationships and in your parenting and your jobs, it can be really overwhelming. And I just want to encourage you today, wherever you're at, it's okay if you feel that way. We're humans, right? We need Jesus. He is our strength and our weakness. We need to allow ourselves to be vulnerable enough to come to Him, express our weakness, express our frustrations, and He can come in and feel that. So I just pray that right now, wherever you are, I just pray that you would allow God's grace, God's incredible, amazing, can't take it away, grace to fill you up. Thank you, God. Come on, let's worship Him. Praise you.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. I'm empty-headed, but not forsaken. I've been set free. I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Whoa, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Whoa, I can see it now. I can see the light in your eyes, laying yourself down and raising up the broken to love. You're amazing, God. You take my failures, you take our weakness. You set your treasures in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel. The world to see your life in me. Yeah. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me. Ooh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see it now. Can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down and raising up the broken to grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see it. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down and raising up the broken to life. Oh, Jesus.
Hey, Grace Family Church, I'm Taylor.
And I'm Nate, and we're in front of our studio right now about to shoot some content for our United Student Ministry.
We are so pumped to be able to bring it to you guys after spending all this time at home during quarantine, and so stay tuned, we can't wait to bring it to you.
Yes, but that's not it. We also have an exciting announcement for you guys, but I'm actually going to throw it over to Will and Pastor Gina for that announcement.
Thanks, Nate and Taylor. This is Pastor Gina White.
And I'm Mr. Will. And parents, boys and girls of all ages, the super fun, exciting announcement that we have is that we'll be reopening Family Ministries next weekend.
The Clubhouse, Zone, and United Middle School will be reopening August 1st and 2nd.
As well as that, United and the Exchange will be reopening August 4th and the 5th.
Parents, we have been closely following guidelines to create best practices for opening safely while having a lot of fun. You can go to the link below for more information.
We're super excited to be meeting again in person. We hope you enjoy the rest of service.
People in dark places need your life.
Oh, God changed me. He gave me a new attitude, a new perspective. Because see, I believe the hope of the world starts with the gospel, getting into a person's heart.
The world is looking for a unified church. It means when you fall, I'm there to help pick you up.
And he says that I want you to be a direction in the darkness. I want you to be a compass in the chaos.
See, the gospel is the power of God, a salvation to those who believe.
But if you can shine your light in dark places, that's where it makes the most difference.
Well, hello, Grace Family Church. My name is Hal Mayer, and I am the Associate Campus Pastor at the Temple Terrace Campus over groups and over care, and I'm also the Young Adults Pastor, which means I'm over something called The Exchange that is going to be meeting again August 4th, 7:30 p.m. on the Waters Campus. And let me just say this. It has been a little bit of a crazy time, huh? I mean, I know this, and some of you have already sensed this. I finally came to this conclusion. I'm just going to share it with you. During this time, I believe the media has been lying to us. Yeah, there's a couple. Here's what I mean by that. I always knew there was something there, but then I saw a story the other day that said during quarantine, the average weight gain of American was only 5 pounds. And I go, that sounds right. Like 5 pounds is not what really happened. 5 pounds is what happens when you're FaceTiming your mom and she says you look a little fluffy and you're like, no, mom, it's just 5 pounds. But really, I'll be honest with you, I gained 15 pounds twice during quarantine. The first time was, I mean, everybody was talking about everything shutting down. So I went to the store, bought every snack I could find, and then ate it in the next 5 days. And then I started getting my life back on track, started working out, started eating healthier, all that. But then when we started to come back, anxiety started to go up, and it wasn't just my anxiety, but the anxiety of everyone else around me, right? You guys know what I'm talking about, that you don't feel anxiety, but everyone around you is like shivering like a bunch of chihuahuas in a freezer, and you're like feeling anxious from that, and they say, hey, don't go to the store hungry, don't go to the store anxious, because you come back with a 4-pack of Totino's pizzas and a box of Twizzlers. Try telling your wife that Twizzlers is keto. I wrap it in bacon, babe, it's okay. That sounds good, actually. But I mean, think about all the things that are going on, the anxiety that we've been feeling. And it's not just COVID-19. It's everything else that's been going on. You see, during the quarantine, we had the deaths of Ahmaud Arbery and Breonna Taylor and George Floyd, which forced America to have the conversation about racism. The problem is America doesn't want to have the conversation about racism. And so what happens is this, is when we refuse to have the conversation, all we hear is the edges. And the edges very rarely want to bring people together and only want to divide. And that's why I'm proud to be a part of a church that has started and will continue to have the conversation on racism. But on top of that, what else do we have going on? We have two seasons colliding. We have election season and hurricane season. And with those things coming together, all of COVID, everything going on, it just seems that everything is crazy. Everything is out of control. Everything is causing anxiety, and we're not sure what to do. And I hear people think, you know, what's the answer for all the anxiety? What's the answer for all the craziness? The answer is not fixing everything out there. The answer is changing the focus in here. Changing the focus off of all the crazy and putting it back to where it needs to be, on Christ. It's taking the focus off everything out there and putting it on what's most important to us, which is the gospel. You see, the church in Acts, the very first church, dealt with similar craziness in their time. I mean, I can't imagine what it would have been like to be alive when Jesus was alive. And you're following Jesus, and you're like, man, this is incredible. He's the Son of God. He's doing all these miracles. We love him. We're following him. Then all of a sudden, he dies, and you're going, I guess he wasn't. And then he raises from the dead 3 days later, and he shows up to more than 500 people. And they're going, man, this is incredible. And Jesus said, here's what I want you to do. Your job for the rest of your life is to share the gospel. And the gospel is this, that while you were still sinning, while you were still messing up, God sent his son, me, to live a perfect life and to die as the perfect sacrifice. And all you have to do is believe in that and repent from your sins. And you get to spend eternity with me. And the disciples thought, that's amazing. We get to tell everybody about the gospel with Jesus. And then one day, they're out in an open field, and Jesus starts to ascend to heaven. How weird would that be? I mean, I'm sure they're watching, and some guy's like, maybe we should have tied a rope to his foot. And they're so stunned by this. They're sitting there just looking up into the heavens that God had to send two angels to go, hey, guys, he's not coming back right now. He's gone, and you have a job to do. See, the nation right now is divided and it's dominated by anxiety. And the way forward is to remember what our focus should be in the gospel. See, when we realize how big the gospel is and what it calls us to do, it forces us as the church to unify. And that's what we see the early church doing is this, is that the gospel was unifying. See, the gospel is unifying. Here's why. It puts us on the same team. No matter what's going on out there, it puts us on the same team. We have the same goal. No matter what pandemic is out there, no matter who is president, no matter who is president, God's still on the throne and we still have a job. See, what we know is this, is that they are stuck in a tough position in the early church. They've got to start the church. How do you start a church? They've got to start pushing the gospel forward. How do you do that? And on top of that, Jesus said, hey, don't leave yet. I'm going to give you someone called the Holy Spirit that's going to give you power. So they are stuck not knowing what to do. And so they spend their time unifying. And this is how they do it. Acts 1:14 says it this way. It says, they all met together and were constantly united in prayer, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, several other women and brothers of Jesus. What did they do? They prayed and they united in prayer. Why? Here's what they knew. Unity follows prayer. Unity follows prayer. And here's why. Because prayer adds a third person. See, it doesn't happen when two people come together, but it happens when two people come together with God. See, this is why we need community so much right now. This is why when we start small groups back again, we all need to be in one. And you're like, how? But COVID. Look, we're gonna have small groups on campus. We're gonna have small groups off campus. We're gonna have small groups online. You're like, how? I don't know how to do online. Just learn how to mute your mic and you'll be fine. But you need to be in community. Why? Because you need to be around other Christians. You need to feel unity in a time of chaos. See, this is why when the church is called to ministry, this is why when someone is called to ministry, prayer is not wasted time, but invested time. And right now we have the opportunity to invest in relationships that we will use as we leave this craziness. See, this is the formula that we see in Acts. It's very simple. Gathering plus prayer equals unity. Gather, pray, unify. Gather, pray with one another, pray for one another. And the answer is unity. And I want you to say this. This was important in the early church, but it's also important in relationships. In fact, spouses, if there's a time in your relationship where you feel distant from your partner, where you feel distant and there's something there, there's some anger, there's an argument, there's something going on, what do? You gather together, you pray with one another, you pray for one another, and see how it changes your heart. It's amazing what happens when I pray for someone, how God changes my heart. It's amazing how when someone prays for me, how it opens my heart. See, when we are looking at the relationships in our life, God says, hey, do this, gather together, pray with one another, pray for one another, and see what happens. Here's what I've seen happen. It changes arguments in the conversations, and conversations turn into answers. See, it works with all of our family. It works in our small groups. It works with our kids. It works in disagreements, because it's hard to stay hateful and jealous and angry with someone when you are united with them in prayer. See, here's what prayer truly is in this. See, prayer is not getting God to do something, but allowing God to do something in me. It's not just getting God to do something, and yes, we do. We ask for things for God, but it's allowing God to change something in me. Even when we can't meet in person, we can pray. I've heard somebody say this, the shortest distance between two people is prayer. Shortest distance, and it's a miracle every time we get to be a part of it. So what do we see them do? They pray, they are unified. And what happens next? God sends the Holy Spirit. See, this is why it's important, because when you take the gospel and you combine it with the Holy Spirit, there's power. There's power. Because not only is the gospel unifying, but the gospel is powerful. The gospel is powerful. See, Jesus told the believers to wait because he knew it's impossible to do the Christian life on your own. It's impossible to do the Christian life. It's impossible to share the Christian life on your own. It requires power. And so we see the Holy Spirit show up in Acts 2. It says, on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like a roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Here's what I want you to get from this. One, the Holy Spirit gives us power. Two, the power it gives us is to overcome barriers to the gospel. See, this was the day of Pentecost, which meant there were people from all different cultures, all different ethnicities, all different languages coming together. What was the barrier at that moment of the gospel? Language. What did the Holy Spirit do? He gave them the ability to speak in different languages. Later on, what do you see? You see the Holy Spirit giving them the ability to heal someone. And what do we see the Holy Spirit doing all the time? Changing hearts. See, what the Holy Spirit does is it removes barriers to the gospel moving forward. And here's why. Because Jesus' mission for us was never to take us from this world, but to empower us in this world with the Holy Spirit. Never wanted to take us out of it, but to empower us to do what he's called us to do. So what does that mean? That means in our lives, those times where we feel overwhelmed, those times where we feel anxious, those times where we say, Jesus, now would be a good time to come back. And we've all been there, are the times where we must plug in to the power source the most, are the times where we need to get as close to the Holy Spirit as possible. So many times I hear people say, well, the gospel is for new believers or unbelievers. No, the gospel is for us. Because it reminds us of who we are and whose we are. And what we see is this, is when we tap into the Holy Spirit, it gives us power. Now, do we try without the Holy Spirit? Absolutely. We try to do it on our own power and we fail and we try and we fail. And then normally we get mad at God and God's going, I never told you to do it on your own. So how do we tap into the power source? Here's the answer. Worship. We worship. And here's what worship is. Worship is proclaiming the gospel out loud. Worship is proclaiming how big God is, what he's done for us, what we know he will continue to do for us, and the promises that we have in him. And when we worship, we remind ourselves of who God is, and we tap into the power source.
Before we continue with the message, let's take a few moments to reflect and worship.
Speaking in the silence, moving in the stillness, calming all the chaos, you are. Joyful in the sadness, comfort in the sorrow, close to the brokenhearted, you are. So give me peace, not of my own. In your presence, I find rest in you alone. Take me to the place where I belong. God, you know me, and you're for me, and you see. Give me peace. Give me peace. Kindness in the hatred, certain in confusion, sureness in hesitation, you are faithful in the struggle.
A couple weeks ago, when we started services back up. I heard that we weren't going to have children's ministry. And to be honest, I was a little bit worried because I was going to bring our three kids into service. And we've got our son who's 6 years old, and we have two foster kiddos that are fraternal twins that are four. And it wasn't that I was worried that they were going to annoy me, because that's daily. I was worried the way they would annoy everyone else. And so I remember walking into service, and the best part was the beginning with the worship, because it was loud and no one could hear them. And our baby girl heard the music and just started dancing, because she's a party wherever she's at. Little man was over in the chair clutching his water bottle, because for some reason he believed that day someone was going to try to steal it. I don't know why. I was like, what are you doing? He's like, somebody's trying to steal my water bottle. I'm like, no, they're not. It's nasty, and you may have COVID. But he just sat there, and he just stared people down. And then I looked over at my son, who's six, and he's just sitting there just observing. Because these were new songs. He hadn't heard them before. I wasn't sure what he was going to do, so I just kind of looked at what he was doing. And then a song came on called Waymaker. And I knew it was a song that he knew. And in that moment, he stepped up. He walked up and he put one hand in the air and he closed his eyes and he started to sing Waymaker. See, I know he doesn't understand all parts of that. And I also know that he used that same hand to smack a kid on the way out. But what I do know is he was understanding a bit of worship. He was sitting there, and I was sitting there and just having a proud dad moment. And in that moment of being proud, jealousy started to seep in. Here's what I mean by that. I was looking at my son. I'm like, man, how incredible it must be to worship without any anxiety or fear of what's going on around you. And I heard God in the back of my mind saying, that's exactly what you're supposed to do. See, that's what worship does. You can't see how big God is and think your problems are big. You can't see how much God loves you and think the world is coming to an end. Yeah, I like the way I heard a pastor say it, you can't worry and worship at the same time. We can't worry and worship at the same time. We can't be overwhelmed by our problems and see how big our God is in front of us. See, when we remember how big God is, we remember how powerful he is, it reminds us that we can't do this on our own, and we need a closeness with him. A closeness that comes only from us spending time in worship and remembering who he is. And it's through that closeness that he gives us that joy that we so desperately need. That hope that the world is longing for, and that joy in the midst of a time that is not filled with happiness. See, here's the gospel that some people don't see. See, the gospel's first job is to change our heart. Then after it works through our heart, it uses us to change others, to be the change in others. That's why when you look at the gospel is not something that, you know, you can only pay attention every other week or every month or every year. The gospel is something that we need in our lives daily. It's something that we need all the time. Let me say it this way. The gospel is life. The gospel is life, both life-giving and life in all of it. See, and I say it that way because so many times the idea of Christianity gets boiled down to just a free bus ticket to heaven. And there's this idea that I became a Christian, that's great. Oh, great, I get my ticket to heaven, but what do I do? Just wait at the bus stop till he comes back? What do I do with my life? And then what do you see? You see Christians going off and just going after their own happiness because they don't realize that the gospel is so much bigger than just a ticket to heaven. The gospel is a calling on all of our lives. See, in the first church, they were in a similar situation. They were growing by thousands, but they were also becoming comfortable. They were becoming comfortable because they had the apostles there, and the apostles were doing all the teaching, and all the church was able to just sit there and listen to what they had to say, but they basically started to forget part of their calling, part of what Jesus said to them. In fact, in Acts 1:8, you see, he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Here's the problem. Had they gone to the ends of the earth? No. Had they gone to Samaria? No. Had they gone to even Judea? No. They had stayed in Jerusalem. They had stayed where it was comfortable. They had stayed where they had their pastors to lean on. See, what happened though, the church grew so much that the religious elite at the time got so angry with the church that they actually at one point decided to stone a young church leader named Stephen. And after they stoned Stephen, it was almost like they were emboldened, and they gave a guy named Saul the ability to go from house to house and pull people out to beat them and to throw them in prison. And so all of a sudden, the church was scared and the church was scattered, and all of the members of the church had a choice to make. Was the gospel something worth dying for? And was the gospel my calling or just the apostles' calling? Let me say it this way. Is the gospel my calling or just the pastor's calling? We see their response in Acts 8:4. It says, but the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. See, I think this is actually the most powerful point in the church, was the moment every single member of the church, every single believer realized that the gospel was a calling on their life. And it wasn't like the persecution stopped. In fact, it worsened from the church and from outside the church. In fact, the Roman Empire at that time was against Christianity. You see Nero throwing Christians into the Colosseum floors to be killed by lions. You see him putting them on a stake and burning them alive. And so it's a horrible time to be a Christian, but the church grew fiercely, so much so that a couple hundred years later, Constantine, who was the emperor of the Roman Empire at that time, looked across a scattered empire and wanted to bring them together. And he goes, what is it that everyone has in common that I can use to bring people together? And even though he didn't believe in Christianity, he made Christianity the state-run religion of the Roman Empire. That's how much it grew. 120 people huddled in a room, scared about what they're going to do next, to the religion of the largest empire on earth. So when people say the gospel isn't big enough, it's just because you don't see it. You don't see the bigness of it. It's so much more than what's right in front of you. I spent 13 years in student ministry. Whenever I would tell people I worked in student ministry, they would be like, oh, that's so awesome. You work in student ministry. You're working with the next generation. But now that I work mainly with young adults and millennials and Gen Z, and I tell people that, they're like, oh, bless your heart. But here's the thing. I always hear this. I'm like, well, what do you have? What's the problem with millennials? And like, well, they have so many causes. They have so many causes. They're going after this and they're going after that. They're going after all these things. And what the statistics show is that millennials and Gen Z, they want to give their life to something that matters. Here's the problem. Those that grew up in church and those that didn't don't see the gospel as big enough to give their life to. They see it as something that's done on Sundays. They see it as something that's done to make you feel better, but it's not something worth giving your life to. And here's what's crazy. None of those causes are bad. The causes that they're going off are not bad at all. In fact, they're great, and there's something that they're passionate about. And actually, if you just take that cause and you put the gospel next to it, it's no longer just a cause, but a calling. It becomes a calling. And here's why that's important, because just because we help people or love people or care for people and meet their needs, but if we don't tell them about the hope that we have, we're missing it. We foster, and this may sound wrong, but I'll just be honest. If you take the gospel away from fostering, it just feels like babysitting. But you add the gospel to foster care, and it becomes transformational. See, when we realize how big the gospel is, and we realize it's our job, it changes the way we see everything. No longer is it just a job or a place I go to school or a place that I'm at. It becomes a mission field. No longer is it just a neighborhood where I'm at, but it's a place where God's given me influence. It's no longer just money that I have that I can use for my own happiness, but it's a gift from God that he's given me for ministry. And no longer is my family just the people that I have to deal with, but they are my first ministry. And my spouse is someone that I sacrificially love for. And my kids are the first disciples God has given me. And it is my job to raise them in a way to follow after him. See, it's so much bigger and it seems overwhelming, but we've got to understand, not only does God give us a big gospel to go after, but he gives us so much in return. See, he promises us the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit brings comfort when things are going crazy. It brings peace when life seems out of control. It brings hope when things are falling apart, and it brings joy in the midst of sorrow. Not only that, God says this, hey, all those pains that you're holding on to, all those things you've gone through, not only do I want to heal them, but I want to use them for something more. And on top of that, I promise you that I will be with you every step of the way. I will never leave you. I will be beside you. And on top of that, yes, the cherry on top is heaven. It's heaven. And sometimes we need to remember heaven, because when everything is going wrong out here, we remember that one day everything will be right up there. See, I get a response from both Christians and non-Christians when I ask a similar question. I'll go up to Christians and I'll say, hey, I need you to understand, God's got a plan for your life. God wants to use you. And I'll hear them say, no, Hal, you don't understand. God wants to use one of those perfect Christians, not me. I've done too much. And then I'll go to non-Christians, I'll say, hey, God wants to forgive you. He's got a plan for you. He wants to save you. And they say the same thing. They go, no, you don't understand how much I've done. God can't forgive me. And my response to both sides is the same. First, I say, hey, you should read the Bible. It's a great book, bestseller. Start off in the New Testament and just see who Jesus picks as his disciples. None of them are first-round picks. And then you see God use a guy named Saul, change his name to Paul. Saul kills Christians. God forgives him and uses him to start churches and write half of the New Testament. So I'll say it like this. You can see it in analogy between two people. You've got Peter and you've got Judas. Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss that led to his death. Peter told Jesus he would be with him the entire way, but then denied him three times, one time to a middle school girl. See, both of them turned their back on Jesus. Both of them walked away, but the way they dealt with their sin was very different. Peter went to Jesus, asked for forgiveness. Jesus forgave him and then used him and molded him into the rock that the church was going to be built on. Judas held on to his sin, felt shame, felt guilt, and took his own life. See, we have a choice. Peter took his sin to Christ, Judas took his to the grave. And we have that same choice. Today, if you're hearing this, you're like, man, I want to start this relationship. I want to take that next step with what it means to be a part of the gospel. It's what I've said before. You just believe in who Jesus is and you repent and say, I've messed up, I've sinned, and God promises that you get to spend eternity with him. So what I want to do right now is in this room, at all the campuses and online, if we could just bow our heads. I want to say a prayer out loud that you can say silently where you're at right now. God, I believe you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for my sins, and that he rose 3 days later. Today, I'm asking for forgiveness of my sins. I've realized I've been wrong. God, today, give me purpose. God, today, give me hope. God, thank you for loving me first. God, thank you for the gospel. God, we thank you for all these things. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that the service was encouraging and inspiring.
Don't forget that the first week of August marks the reopening of all of our family ministries.
And please be sure to follow us on all of our social media platforms for the latest updates.
Again, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next week.